In German, there's a phonological rule called final devoicing. When a syllable ends in a voiced obstruent, it is replaced by a voiceless one. Hence, this is pronounced rat, and this is pronounced objektiv. As you see, the d and v, which are voiced, are replaced by their voiceless counterparts, t and f. But you're very smart, so when you look at this, you go, hang on, can't we just say that rat ends in a t? And objektiv ends in a f? Sure, they're spelled weirdly, but writing systems aren't always accurate to the actual language. Speakers of English are acutely aware of that. In German, there is no final devoicing. The word is just rat. And that's very clever. But let me present you with some new data. Sure, a German would say, das ist objektiv, but as soon as the word takes adjective endings, as in eine objektive Meinung, that f becomes a v. The plural of Rat is Räder, its genitive is des Rades, with a D. So you say, here we can make a new rule. Voiced consonants like T at the end of a syllable become voiced, like D, when we add a vowel after it. Except that doesn't quite work either, because the word Rat also exists in German, and its genitive is des Rates, and its plural is die Räte, with a hard T all the way through. To explain this discrepancy, linguists use the terms underlying representation and surface representation. The surface representation of, in this case, a word, is its physical manifestation in the real world. It is its actual realization, the thing you say and the thing you hear when speaking. The underlying representation, on the other hand, is the abstract form in which a word is stored in a mind. Now, we could say all words in German are stored the way they are said, that is, the surface and underlying representations are identical, and indeed, this is often true. But in the case of Rat, how would the speaker then store the fact that the T becomes softened to a D in all the other forms of this word? Alright, let's say that Rat has a special tag on it that tells us to turn its final T into a D, one that Rat doesn't have, thus explaining the difference. But then we look at all the data, and we notice that voiced obstruents never occur at the end of a syllable, and that this pattern with voiceless consonants transforming into voiced ones as soon as they're not at the end of a syllable anymore is extremely common, and yet completely unpredictable. And we look at historical linguistics and see that the final obstruents in these words used to in fact be voiced, but lost this feature in the course of language change. And we realize that, hang on, it's actually just simpler to say that the underlying representation of rat is rad, with a voiced d sound, and the ur of objektiv is objektiv, and so on and so on. But the German has this phonological rule called final devoicing, where when the syllable ends in a voiced obstruent, it is replaced by a voiceless one. Okay, but now, you're asking what this has to do with toddlers. Well, I had to explain all that so that I could tell you about the theory that this toddler language analysis is based on, and that would be OT, which disagrees with everything I just said. I mean, sort of. Optimality theory, or OT for short, does use the concepts of underlying and surface representations as I laid them out to you. The disagreement comes in this bit here, the rule. In a rules-based phonology, we say that we get from the UR to the SR by applying a series of language-specific rules. In English, the word objective keeps its V at the end because English doesn't have a final devoicing rule, but the German UR, objektiv, becomes objektiv, because German does. I'm not going to get into it fully here, but we can think of it as a function machine. We start at the UR and send it through this rule here to transform it into the SR. OT has a different model of how URs become their SRs, not rules-based, but constraints-based. So in OT we have the UR and then we have a generator, which creates a massive bunch of candidates which are then fed into the evaluator. The evaluator determines which candidate is the most appropriate to be chosen as a surface representation, based on a series of constraints. We can model this evaluator as a table. So say we have the UR bad, we can call this the input. And one candidate that is identical to the input, one that is bad, and one that is part. And for the sake of simplicity, we'll say we have two constraints. One is that all the voiced consonants in the input should be voiced in the output. Let's call that one ident IO voice, identical input output with regards to the feature voice. The other is a ban on voiced obstruents at the end of a syllable. We can just call that one findev for final devoicing, though technically it should be represented like this. Constraints are ranked by importance, represented in the table with the most highly ranked constraints being at the left and the lower ranked ones at the right. What happens when you evaluate candidates is you evaluate the entire left column first, and anyone that breaks the constraint in that column is eliminated. And then you go to the next column and the next until you only have one candidate left. This means that the winning candidate, the one that becomes the SR, or output, will also break constraints, and that's fine, it just needs to be the last candidate standing, the least bad option. In German, we say FinDev is ranked higher than Identio Voice, so we put it here on the left, and we take our three candidates and check them all against this constraint first. So Bad, that one disappears instantly because it breaks against FinDev. Out it goes, but our other two candidates end in voiceless consonants, so they're still possible. Now we examine the next column. Bad is the best in this column, it doesn't break Identio at all, but unfortunately it's already been eliminated. Bad breaks this constraint once, because we have one element here where we've changed the voice value of a sound, gone from D to T. Pat, though, breaks against this constraint twice, because it's gone from B to P and from D to T. That means it gets eliminated. Now Bad still breaks a constraint, but it's the only one left, so it becomes the output. Here, instead of rules being language-specific, all constraints are present in all languages, but the ranking of them has changed. If we do the same exercise in English for the English word bad, we can just switch Identio Voice and FinDev around to get the correct results. Because this identity is more important than FinDev in English, bat and pat get eliminated first, and bad remains the least bad candidate, becoming the output. Now that clever brain of yours kicks in again and you ask, why in the world would you want a model like this? It is unnecessarily complicated and weird and unintuitive. Like, why insist that English has this secret hidden final devoicing constraint that just gets overridden in literally every single word? It feels so much easier to just say that that rule doesn't exist in English. And while I don't necessarily disagree with that criticism, I kind of get why this model is the way it is. And it's because of early language acquisition. See, when toddlers are starting to put together their first words, and then their first little phrases and sentences, they have a very interesting phonology. For instance, cross-linguistically, they tend to have preferences for certain types of sounds over others. Coronal sounds like T and S are often the best, and then labial sounds like P or F. And dorsal sounds like K and G are often avoided. We can see an example of this from my own language learning, where I used to say the word jordgubbar, which is Swedish for strawberries, as bubba, replacing that unwanted G with a much more pleasant B. In OT, we can use a table to model this, saying that there's actually a constraint in language against the use of every single sound. But the constraint against G for me at this age was ranked higher than the constraint on B. So saying bubba was less bad than saying gubba. We can also see another couple potential constraints at play here. First, one against degenerate feet. I'm not going to explain that one, I'll just leave you with the knowledge that degenerate feet is a real linguistic term. And second, one against final consonants, a constraint we call no coda. In my child Swedish, I was just avoiding a final consonant at any cost, even if that meant deleting an element of the word. Prince and Smolensky, the creators of OT, give an example of a child using the word ta for bat, once again avoiding a final consonant by deleting it, and switching out a labial sound for the preferred coronal sound, t. But that's not all. See, I still understood the word jordgubbar. The child in Prince and Smolensky's example understands the word bat. What we've done here in our analysis is actually that we've taken jordgubbar and bat as the underlying representations of these words in the mind of the child. These are used as the input for our grammar, but the output has to conform to certain constraints. These are called structure constraints, things like FinDev and no coda, the constraints against specific sounds. These are the ones that ban things, that stop you from doing things, that force a difference between the input and output. These are in contradiction with faithfulness constraints, like the Identio Voice that we had earlier. They describe in different ways how the output should stay the same as the input. We shouldn't change the voicing of sounds. We shouldn't change the position of sounds, that's Identio Place. We shouldn't get rid of sounds we don't like, that's Maxio. But in a toddler language, structure constraints outrank faithfulness constraints. The limitations on speech are much more important than replicating the input in the output. So yes, outcome words like ta and bubba You can model the OT tables like this in a kind of simplified way, with no coder outranking max.io, and the place constraints outranking ident.io place. But when an English acquiring toddler hears the word bat, or a Swedish acquiring one hears the word jordgubbar, well, they are still able to tell which word is meant, suggesting that they have stored the word in its entirety in their brains. These adult words break all the structure constraints anyway, so on the perceptive level, the structure constraints are irrelevant, and they know which you are the adult is getting at because of the faithfulness constraints. Thus, the discrepancy between word perception and production of toddlers. And do you know what many toddlers do as they learn English? They devoice their final consonants! They say that's bat instead of that's bad. But through the constant stream of correct data from the language around them, they learn to rank the faithfulness constraints higher than the structure constraints, and the children start saying all the phonemes of their language. They say voiced consonants at the end of words, they stop throwing out the final consonants of syllables. Well, almost. If there are never any syllable final voiced consonants in the data, like in German, that FinDev constraint never gets demoted, and it keeps outranking ident.io voice, automatically applying itself to every new word they learn, and carrying over to when they try to learn new languages as teenagers or adults. And sure, max.io comes to outrank no coder, but this constraint still comes into play in adult German, with words like backen being syllabified backen, not backen, avoiding coders wherever this wouldn't violate max.io. That is, we avoid syllable final consonants as long as we can do so without getting rid of any information. Thus, the constraints still exist, but they've been demoted and promoted throughout childhood to reach the balance that we have in the adult language. And that is how linguists have ended up with a model with secret, hidden, non-existent constraints in every language all the time on every word. And that's very satisfying and quite cool, but there are a lot of things that don't add up about this model. I don't fully buy it. Like, not every child goes through a stage of final devoicing in their language learning. And then, hey, take the generator that's supposed to produce the various candidates for evaluation. Remember that? I wouldn't blame you if you've already forgotten it since I largely skipped over it, but I wouldn't blame me either since the majority of linguists seem to have skipped over that bit too. I mean, there are a lot of complex ideas linguists have about how the generator works, how it knows when to stop generating new candidates, how it's even possible that the correct candidate actually gets generated every time and is therefore available for selection by the evaluator every time. But there are serious questions to be asked about these, because as often happens in the cognitive sciences, massive parts of the theory seem to be created in order to justify the theory itself, rather than referring back to evidence from, or suggesting any explanations for, real observable phenomena. And when first introduced to it, I kind of felt that way about the entirety of optimality theory, but it does model a major part of empirical reality that most models can't really handle. It tells us why toddlers talk like that, why they can understand so much more than they can say, how they start speaking properly, and I appreciate it for that strength. At least it's certainly better than a lot of other generative grammar.